Hello, hello everybody. Good afternoon. A very warm welcome to you all. Thank you all for joining us this afternoon. I'll just say hello, hello again as you're all coming through the waiting room and joining us for another CPD standards webinar. It's an absolute pleasure to have you all this afternoon and really excited to talk about today's topic of returning to the workplace. For those of you that haven't met me before, my name's Amanda Rosewarne. I am CEO and co-founder of the Professional Development Consortium, which is home to the CPD Standards Office and also Coach of Excellence and Provider of Training Excellence. And as many of you know, we've been running this webinar series now ever since the pandemic started as a way to support you in our global community as trainers, coaches, and online educators. To find those tools, find those resources, and make connections with one another as we go through this incredible time in history. So just welcoming more people in now, delighted to see you all, and thank you for sharing your time with us today. So I'm delighted to welcome our speaker, Simon Rickman, this afternoon. He is a member of the Chartered Institute of Personnel and Development, the CIPD, and has been accredited with the CPD Standards Office now for some time. He's a leadership coach and mentor, and he really specialises with working with individuals and teams to get significant change within their performance and works with clients to really understand their people challenges and basically produce workable business solutions. Over the past year or so, he's pivoted his workshops and coaching to create fun and informative webinars, which is what we're really looking forward to today, particularly how to work from home effectively and how to find a job. So he's worked with all sorts of departments and functions and high performance teams, including Accenture, American Express, and lots of other SMEs and charities. So I hope I've done you a good service, Simon, with introducing you, and a very warm welcome. So as we run this webinar, we're going to take questions in the chat as they come through. By all means, put down your thoughts, your interests, and your observations of what we're talking about today. And then we also have a longer Q&A session at the end. So I'm delighted to be handing over to you, Simon. So tell us more. Tell us about how we can return to the workplace effectively and safely.
Amanda, thank you so much. Just before I do that, two things. Number one, having a slot straight after lunch is a bit of a challenge for everyone. I'm not sure if you're a graveyard slot.
Graveyard slot, yeah.
It is traditionally that. I'm not sure if it is so much now that we're doing things from home. The thing that I'm thinking of is I've got anything in my teeth. I've just had some soup and everything and vegetables, and I'm now very conscious I've got some
You're
stuff.
looking fine to me, Simon. You're looking
Thank
fine
you.
to me.
The other is I do have a dog, and my dog is just outside the room here. And if she barks, I'm going to apologize in advance, but also feel quite chilled about it because I think about a year ago, probably when we started this back in April, when people really started to do webinars, we were very conscious of everything and we had to be absolutely perfect. And then gradually we realized that having, the postman knock on the door and the dogs barking and children walking and all that kind of stuff, we're much more chilled about it. So if it does happen, I will be very resilient and I'll just keep pushing through. So working from home, first I did 22nd of April, I was saying to Amanda and Kirsty just before, it's very circular that I'm now talking about returning to the workplace. And it's a big challenge. It's a big challenge for all of us. And again, I was just saying to Kirsty and to Amanda, I don't think this is finished. We've only just started this part of the journey. I'm quoting here from The Independent, and of course, our Prime Minister said that it was originally in June and then it went to July. We're still moving away from where we were before, but we have the opportunity to work back in the office or wherever you're working, but where you can. And he was urging extreme caution. He's expecting us, giving us the choice, to take responsibility for our health and safety and the health and safety of those people around us. So we had to take that personal responsibility. So the good news is that we've got this green light. We can get back to the workplace. But the question that I started to ask myself and ask other people, particularly my clients, is, okay, how do you feel about it? If you think back to March the 23rd, 2020, how did you feel about being told that you had no choice, that you had to come out of a place where you had worked for years and years and years? Not just you as an individual, but the representation of us working in an office environment or retail environment, wherever it was. We had no choice. And now we're being given the choice of going back to the office. So how does that make us feel? Are we ready for it? And indeed, is your company prepared and are you in alignment? And one of the questions we're asking is, okay, what's it going to look like? Am I going to be offered this flexible working? We're hearing lots of different words over the last 18 months, and a new word for us to get used to now is this hybrid solution. I'll talk about that shortly. And what sort of support am I going to get from my organization? Is my line manager going to support me? How are we going to make the best use of office space? What's it going to look like from a health and safety perspective? And what's so important here is recognizing that everybody's situation is unique. We are all different. One of the expressions that we had about a year ago, people were saying, we're all in the same boat. No, we weren't. We were on our own boat, our own ship, in the same storm, but we were on our own boat. And indeed, we're seeing this now. So when I talk to my clients, I know some of them are incredibly excited about getting back to the workplace. One of the reasons is they're fed up. You know, they want to interact with people. That's what we're used to doing. Some of them are very lonely. Some of them find that they can't get recognition that they could when you're all in one place. But at the same time, I know some of my other clients are confused because they're not sure, why are you asking us to go back to the office when we have proved that we can be just as productive, maybe more productive, working from home? Some of us have got so used to working from home, looking after children, doing home education, being a carer, just getting more control over our lives, that as equally there are people who are excited and elated about it, there are some people who are confused. And one of the key messages that I'm going to, you know, put across today is, just because you are feeling something, somebody else may be feeling something quite different, and we need to be aware of that. So I think in terms of outcome, what we should be looking for is whatever is best for you to do your job. And I think to do that, what I'm saying to my clients is that I think we need three things. First of all, we need not just leadership, but we actually need enlightened leadership. I was saying to Kirsty and Amanda that I think we're in an evolutionary phase of the working world, the working environment. Again, not just in the UK, but worldwide. Now, I've been working for nearly 40 years. And I'm thinking about where I've seen the biggest changes. And one of the biggest changes I saw was in the mid-90s, when we had things like laptops for the first time. Prior to that, you had to work at your desk. Either you had a desktop, or when I started work, we didn't have computers. I can go back that far. But we had to be at that workplace. Once you got laptops from the early 90s, you were not wedded to your workplace. So to me, that was the last time when we really had an opportunity to make some significant changes to the way that we worked. So we need enlightened leadership. Secondly, I think we need to be resilient. And how? And if you think about the journey that we've been on over the last 18 months, and I'll share with you a slide that I've created on that, we've had to learn to take a lot of bumps along the way, actually being told, as I said, that we have to go into lockdown. Then we're only allowed out for an hour. Then we can start to see one or two people. Then we've got to wear these masks. Then we can start going back to the workplace. Oh, no, we're going to another lockdown. All of those things are going to have an impact on how we feel. And indeed, we talk about mental health now in a way that we didn't do before. And it's from a positive perspective. And the third thing, given what I've said, which I think it goes along with it, is that we have to be agile. So being told to come out of your work environment and working from home, then how do I do that? Then coming out of that and going back to the workplace, and how do we do that? Demonstrates that we have to be agile. The fact that I, in terms of my business, my background is HR and in recruitment, and I've been doing coaching for the last 2.5 years, I was going into my clients' workplaces. Then all of a sudden I couldn't do that. I wasn't allowed to. So everything has had to go online. So I've had to, another word, pivot, a word we didn't use in that way before, and show agility. And I'm sure there's lots of examples that you've experienced yourself. So Amanda's talked about some of this already, so apologies, but it's worth just reinforcing it. I do try and make my webinars as active as possible. We're going to have some polling questions. They are anonymous, let me assure you, and they are purely voluntary. It just makes it interesting. If you can keep yourself on mute, then that will be great. There will be an exercise. So if you have a pen and paper ready, I'll let you know when that is. Again, if you want to participate. I've already mentioned the polling questions. That's really interesting. To me, that really reinforces what you're thinking and comparing it to what other people are thinking as well. Now, we also know, because we are now not novices at using Zoom anymore, we've become somewhat expert at using it. We know that if you've got other applications open, and I have got some videos, it can interfere and can slow them down. So I just encourage you to close them down. And in terms of questions and answers, there are two opportunities. At the end of each section, I've got a slide that says, do you have any questions? Put them in the chat. If you want to come off of mute and ask that question, we can do that. We need to monitor time. And Amanda's very kindly going to monitor that, and we can look at the end if necessary. So beginning with the end in mind, we have an opportunity to think about the future of our work, not just about going back to work on the 19th of July. And I know some people have been doing that, but actually the future shape of our work. But this is going to require more change. And we've had a lot of change. We've had so much change in the last 18 months. It's very taxing on us. And what I'm going to do with the webinar is provide you with a range of some insights and thoughts and suggestions. I've done lots of research and it's spoken to people, but it's probably going to leave you with more questions and answers. Because I think with this type of webinar, I can't tell you what to do, not that I would want to do that. I can only advise. But I think one thing that has to happen here is we have to make a decision. We have to be purposeful. And I think you can use some of what I'm talking about as part of a discussion so you can sit down with your line manager and level your own level of risk. So with my webinars, there are three things that I try and achieve. The first one is to increase your self-awareness. And I can assure you there will be things that I talk about that you will already know. And what my clients say to me is, oh, Simon, I already knew that, but thanks for reminding me. I kind of forgotten about it. Some might say, oh, yes, I knew that already. And so, yeah, I'm going to take some action with it. Then it's about perhaps changing your attitude. Because, of course, I don't know what you know. And therefore, me talking about some of these things, is I get very passionate, very enthusiastic about it. And it might change your attitude. And thirdly, it's about taking action. And I think in this one in particular, I would always encourage my clients to take action. But I really think you have to take action. You can't just stay where you are. You have to make a decision to the greater or lesser extent with your line manager. Am I going to go back to work? Is it going to be hybrid? Is it full time? All these sort of things. So let's talk about polling. Let's just go to our first poll. And I'm just going to admit somebody so I can move that out of the way. And we're going to ask you the question. So let's launch the poll. How are you feeling at the moment? How comfortable do you feel about returning to your workplace right now? So I'm going to give you 30 seconds. So I'm going to put you on a bit of pressure. And I'll count down when we get to, I can see the numbers are racking up. I like to get sort of over 80% if I can. So when we get to 25, I'm going to count it down from now. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. And I'm just thinking, actually, I think it was somebody from the CPDSO who did that first. And I thought it was brilliant. So I'm copying him because I think it was really cool. Right, we have 87%. Thank you for your participation. Now let's end the poll and let me share the results with you. So very interesting. I mentioned before, and I'll keep mentioning it, some of you are feeling supremely comfortable, right? It's about 7%, okay? About a third of you are feeling very comfortable, but a third are also feeling relatively comfortable. There are still people, 20% are feeling quite anxious, and some people feeling very nervous. The point is that if you're one of those people who's feeling very comfortable, supremely comfortable, great, that's fantastic. Be aware that you are not on your own. There'll be other people that will be feeling like you. And more importantly, there are other people who aren't. So I think it's just contextually, we just need to be aware of that. So let me just close that poll. Thank you for sharing that. So those of you who have heard of The Seven Habits of Highly Effective People by Stephen Covey, I am an absolute disciple. I'm a massive fan and I use it in a lot of my workshops and webinars. And so I use Covey's Seven Habits as a roadmap. Now look at the quotes. I have a lot of quotes. Returning to work is likely to be unpredictable and potentially chaotic. In other words, what experts are predicting is this is not going to be easy. So where we want to get to is some people feeling a little bit anxious about it. By the end of our journey, we're going to feel more resilient and able to cope. And I've only got time to talk about three of the habits today. So I've chosen habit number one, which is be proactive. And this is about making the right decision. Then I'm going to talk about habit number two, which is called begin with the end in mind. And this is about questioning why. Why are we doing this? Not just what, but why are we doing? What's the purpose of this? And then I'm going to skip number three, and I'm going to talk about habit number four, which is called think win-win. And I want to talk to you about a psychologically safe environment. I don't know, some of you may have heard of it. I work with a lot of business psychologists, and this is the in thing, and there's a real relevance for it. But how psychologically safe do you feel about saying how you would like to see your next stage at work, whether you want to go back or not? So I've chosen that one. And just to prove that I do know that there are seven habits, which unfortunately we can't talk about today, here are the other four. So let's start with habit number one. This is being proactive. It's all about making the right decision. Now, we know, we've just seen through the polls that some people are ready to go back to work, which is great, but it might just be a little bit harder than we think.
You're also going to need to adjust to not taking a nap every day.
We're keeping that. Keeping that one.
You need to go to bed on time.
And stop watching Netflix.
How?
Push through.
Fine. Okay, moving on to going to work.
I've been going to work.
No. Like putting on clothes and makeup and going to an office.
What?
Once you get to the office, let's practice a workplace meeting.
I've been doing this all month. I got it.
Okay. Hi, Kim. How are you?
I'm good.
Our projections are in for Q3. In order to hit that target, we're going to have to buckle down. We're going to have to circle back. We're going to have to... Kim, are you on your phone?
Don't worry about it. It's out of the shop. You can't see it.
You are not on a Zoom call anymore. You're in person. We can see you.
I am.
Continue. We really need to meet that goal in order to meet expectations and deliverables and cash flow. Kim, are you doing a TikTok dance?
You can't tell because I'm in screen share. You just see charts.
This is not a Zoom call. We can see you.
Whatever.
In order to meet those expectations, we're going to have to buckle down, but we're going to have to gear up and then we'll circle back with our synergy. And oh my God, Kim, stop eating pretzels.
You can't hear it. I'm on mute.
There's no mute.
This is hard.
Okay, you're going to be fine. It's okay. Everybody's going to be going through the same thing. So just drive to work and just figure it out. Okay.
Oh, crap. I think I forgot how to drive.
So it's just being aware that some people are going to struggle more than others. Look, the reason for this is we want to get back some sort of control. The last 18 months have demonstrated that we haven't had the same degree of control that we've had in the past. I'm quoting here from Deloitte. You may have heard of Deloitte. It's one of the largest management consultancies in the world. And they say their typical crisis plays out over three timeframes: respond, recover, and thrive. So how can we use that particular model to explain where we are today? Well, whether you've known it or not, we've been living in what is called a VUCA world. And I'll explain what VUCA means. And in essence, we have been living with lots and lots of change since the breakup of the Soviet bloc back in the early 1990s. And what's happened since COVID-19, sort of 18 months ago, that pace of change and that instability went into overdrive. So if we thought we were going through lots of change and how to cope with that, it just went absolutely crazy. So if you look at the model, you can see the V stands for volatility. If we go back to the beginning of this horrendous story back in January 2020, all of a sudden coronavirus, this is hitting the world. Okay, we're feeling volatile. We're kind of thinking it's in Wuhan. Where the hell's Wuhan? China? Oh God, that's thousands of miles away. But we're realizing actually this is not just going to keep in Wuhan. We're feeling volatile. And then we get this degree of uncertainty. There's a lack of information because we haven't experienced this before. So we start to see some uncomfortable behaviors. We start to see, particularly, remember that panic buying that we have, people being very selfish. And then we realize that, you know what? We don't actually know what the answer to this is really complex. And it's difficult to kind of determine what to do, when to do it, and how to do it. And that's because there's been a lot of ambiguity. And one of the biggest downsides that we saw as a result of this, there wasn't one worldwide approach of how to deal with this. Every government was doing its own thing and hence was getting criticized. You were too early, you're too late, all that kind of stuff. We didn't know who was right and who was wrong. And so because we were no longer in control of our destiny, we had to make a response. And we started to see a response 18 months ago. So we get that, well, remember, it's unprecedented times. That was the excuse, but it was true. We start to work from home. We're hearing this word furlough that we hadn't heard of before. The pivot I mentioned, vaccines, all this kind of stuff is a response to the situation that we're in. And during those lockdowns, we found that actually doing any forecasting and prediction was extremely difficult. And Carolyn Everson, who's a VP at Facebook, said, do you know what, guys? We're just doing this on the fly. We haven't done it before. We're making it up as we go along. But as we start to do that, as we start to focus on positive outcomes, we get into that next phase, which is recovery. So we become more resourceful. We start working together. All that clapping for the NHS, we're doing something positive. And so Edward Gabor then came out last summer. He said, you know what, we need to move to thrive and we need to look at VUCA in a much more positive way. So if you go back to the model on the left hand side, what he said is, let's move volatility to vision. What is it going to look like? What are our core values? Yeah, this why bit, why are we here? What's our purpose? And remind everybody what we're all about. We can change the uncertainty to understand, okay, what have we learned as a result of where we've been and how can we put that into practice in the future? We can change complexity into clarity. And what's absolutely important is the clarity that we need to be open, to focus, to let people know what they can and can't do. It's one of the big criticisms, lack of clarity, people don't know, they make the wrong choices. And finally, we can change ambiguity to adaptability, that agility that I was talking about. And we can think about from an environmental, from a competitive, from a strategic perspective, we can start to become more adaptable. So a good opportunity to go back to our polls, and let's just launch poll number 2. So here we go. So again, just out of interest, it's anonymous. We're not interested in who, we're interested in the results. But in which phase do you think your organization, are they still responding to the crisis? Or are they in that recovery mode? Or have they gone beyond that and they're actually in that thriving mode? Or indeed, if you don't know, then just put it into the don't know. So I'll give you 30 seconds, put you on a little bit of pressure, and I'll count that down. So we've got 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. I'm going to have a glass of water to give a bit more time. As we get to 79, I'm happy with 79%. Let's end the poll. So this is really interesting. I do this a lot, so I'm going to share the results. So the majority of people have moved out of responding, though there are still a smaller number of people or organizations in that responding. But most people are in that recovering, but we're beginning to see people in thriving. So over half of the people are in recovering, but we're beginning to see about a quarter in thriving. Now, I've been doing this webinar for the last month or so to a number of clients. And I'm seeing very similar trends. And I would expect, you know, in a month's time, I would like to see more people in that thriving. So again, just worth the emphasis, wherever you are, somebody else is somewhere else. So no one knows the right answer. And there's a really good survey that Hays, the big recruitment organization, ran a few months ago. So you had over 4,000 responses, so it's very valid. So let me share the results with you. And they asked the question, do you think we will go back to the traditional 9-to-5 office-based working environment? Interesting result, not what I would have predicted. So simple employee-employer split, 43%. So the majority of employers are saying, no, we don't think that's going to return. What's really interesting, when you break those employees down into levels, look at what the results are saying. So the more senior you are, so that management director C-suite, the more senior you are, the more likely you're going to say, I don't think we're going to return. Whereas the more junior, younger people probably are thinking that it will return. And when you break it down into those generations, I've just put some dates there. They're roughly what we would call the baby boomers, which is where I am, up to the Generation Zs, up to sort of 2010. look at what it's saying. The younger you are, the more likely is that you think that we will return to that 9 to 5, where the old fogies like me think that we won't. I would have said the other way around, but so what? It was interesting. They also said in that survey, what do you think the biggest challenges are going to be? And you can see, so nearly a third were saying, what are the working arrangements going to be like? We don't know what that's going to be like. And then a quarter was saying, yeah, what impact is that going to have on our morale? How is it going to motivate us? And there are some of the other answers as well, weren't as significant. So what I call going the extra mile, in other words, for you to take away with you, think about where do you and your organization stand? You know, and how, with where you stand, how is that going to stand with other people that work within your organization? So that's something for you to think about and take away. So if we go back to the 7 habits, habit number 1 is being proactive. But look at what PwC, again, one of the largest management consultants, they kind of know what they're talking about. Navigating the pandemic aftermath will be one of the biggest business challenges of our time. Let's not underestimate this. And what I look at here is the stimulus response theory. So let's look at it. So the event is that we're going to return to work. And the response is, okay, when are we going to do that? What are we going to do? Why are we going to do it? How are we going to do it? And the bit in the middle, which is the key thing, we have the freedom to choose. And the responsibility right at the start of this is that management have to take responsibility for starting that conversation. That is their responsibility. And that's where I get involved with a lot of senior managers, say, right, okay, let's sit down and think about how you're going to communicate and what it's going to look like. But the other thing that I'm saying to everybody is get involved in that. Don't just accept what happens to you. I know that's very traditional, it's very hierarchical, but you can get involved in that. And when you start thinking about it, that impact of whatever you decide to do will impact you as an individual. It will impact you within your team. It will impact you within your organization. It will impact you and the way that you interact with your customers. And what we know is that there is no one solution. No one person knows all the answers. So stop trying to find the golden solution. It doesn't exist. Be more flexible. Take that pressure off yourself to think about what it is and try some of those things. And recognize, as I said before, that work may never be the same again. So take the opportunity to get involved in that, because it's an opportunity to change the way that we work. But in order to do that, what I would encourage my clients to do is focus on positive outcomes. I think you have an opportunity, a real opportunity to strengthen your culture, to re-engage with your colleagues and your customers and think about that. And then the other thing to think about is, okay, from a legal perspective, and I know I've been on lots of webinars that have talked about the legal implications of that, that's a biggie. And I'm not covering that in this topic, but it's something that's why I'm saying don't rush to make changes legally to contracts, but pilot, try things, see what it's like. And it's not going to be easy. So if you look at the head of public policy at the CIPD, he said employers should be seeking to meet individual work preferences as much as possible. Great. But at the same time, you need to make sure the needs of the organization are fully met. And that's where there is a challenge. So I would encourage people to work in what we call the circle of influence. This is where we're much more positive. What can we do? How do we be bold? How do we think from a half full perspective? Because the alternative to that is what we call the circle of concern. These are things that they bother us. We're concerned about them, but we can be negative. We've always done it that way. That's why we're doing it that way. I don't think that flies anymore. It's very much a half empty attitude. And in terms of what we want to see coming out of this, number one, without any question or doubt, is the health and safety of everybody. That has to be management's top priority. And I did go to a client a couple of weeks ago to run a workshop face-to-face, which was great. But looking at all the signs that they had and all the sanitation and all that kind of stuff was there, which made me feel safe. The second thing is to have that agility, which I talked about right at the beginning. You've got to decide who you want to bring back and when. Well, just step back and think about when that's going to be and take responsibility for it, because it will have serious implications for the people who work for you. And from a leadership point of view, please listen and then lead with empathy. Understand, not just from your perspective, we've looked at some of the polls where people have their own perspectives, but think about the perspectives of other people as well. Plan for multiple scenarios. Things are gonna shift. We've seen the timescale shift, and adapt to different situations. So another go in the extra mile is, where do you tend to focus and why? Are you the type of person that tends to live and focus on their circle of influence, that half full attitude, or are you the type of person that tends to focus on, we can't do it, woe is me, that kind of cloud that's around your head all the time? Again, just something to think about. And we know it's not straightforward. And we know this is being discussed in the wider arena. And this is something that was on Coronation Street last week that I decided to download, because it's saying that everybody is. So that type of conversation and has been going on in boardrooms up and down the country, I'm sure across the whole world. And it's carrying on. My wife and I watch Coronation Street for breakfast every morning. And we watched it this morning, and they started to talk about it again, the implications of that. It's there, it's happening. So if any of you've got any questions at this stage, can I suggest that you put it in the chat, and that let's pick it up at the end. I think I'm just conscious of time. And I think if you put it in there, you don't forget what the questions are, and then we'll pick them up. Amanda can pick them up at the end for us. So let's move on to habit number two. This is beginning with the end in mind. And this is all about questioning your why. Why are we doing this? And if we think about our journey that we've had over the last 18 months or so, we have gone through masses of change. So if you look at the diagram that I've got there, you can see on the bottom, we've got lockdown one, we've got Christmas, and we've got the future, etc. So let me reveal a journey. Look at that. The ups and downs of what's been happening to me over the last 12 months. And I'm sure your journey has been similar, maybe different, but it'll be similar. And if we go through that journey, we go right back to the beginning. We were terribly confused. We said before, we felt very volatile. We don't understand this. And as we start to get used to kind of what's going on here, okay, fine, we've got to do something about it. And then we go into lockdown one, and that this was the plug. This was like, hold on, in our society, our government is telling us to stay from home, and we're going to go one hour a day. What's going on? But we start to get used to it. And fortunately, we had some good weather last year, and we started to get used to that. We even went into lockdown two. It wasn't so bad. He allowed us to have a couple of people around at Christmas. That was great. But then I think we had the biggest shock when we go into lockdown three. That was really hard. And that's where I started to talk about resilience, the seven habits of highly resilient people, because my clients were saying to me, what are we going to do about this? And people were finding that really hard. But then we started to adjust again. And then we started to say, hold on, you know what? I've heard about this vaccine, this whatever, AstraZeneca and all this kind of stuff. So people start to feel positive again and we get to that peak. But after that peak, we find, oh my God, we've got a vaccine, what, 55 million people? And we start to get very judgmental. We're going to have to go back to work. What's going to happen? And one of the very interesting things that I think comes out of this is thing here I've got called reverse culture shock. And what reverse culture shock is saying is, do you know what? I've got so used to my habit of working from home. Actually, I think it's going to be a bit more of a challenge. So as we start to readjust for the future, I don't think we're going to see a continuation going up. I think we're still going to see some peaks and troughs, because we just don't know. So beginning with the end in mind, we can't deny the fact there is no longer a separation between work and home life. When I first started to work, you say, you want to work from home? Are you kidding? We just don't do that here. And so people have started to think about, okay, what's it going to look like? So what I've got here is it's an example. There are lots and lots of examples. This one's from LinkedIn, somebody I'm LinkedIn with. She did a poll of 400 people. Look, 2 to 3 days a week, 78% want to do that. PwC, there they are again. They said March, they said, right, staff can spend between 40 and 60% at the offices and the rest working from home. The bit that I've taken out said, and they can take Fridays off in July and August. That's what they said. Goldman Sachs said, no way. We are not allowing people to not come back to work. They have to come back to the office. Interesting. And what we need to think about is, this is a business imperative. We have to define our purpose, our end in mind. What do we want our workplace to look like? And that clarity, again, is critical. So we need to explain to people, why are we doing what we're doing, before we talk about the what and the how. And we can no longer say, well, it's just traditional. We can't say that anymore. And we need to be aware that actually, do you know what? We don't have to put ourselves under immense pressure to do this. We can take our time. We can pilot things. We can try them. We can talk to people. We can listen. And so what I'm saying to my clients is, it's an opportunity for you as leaders, just go beyond that data. Yeah, all the numbers, I get it, they're important, but listen, be enlightened, listen from other people's perspective, be open to that and help you to make a more informed decision. So let's go back to the polls then. And now let's ask you poll number three. Oops, me clicking away in the wrong thing. Here we go. So let's launch. Do you have a policy or do your organization have a policy for returning to the workplace? Is it clear? So again, I'll give you 30 seconds. We're coming up for 25 and 4, 3, 2, 1. There's still people participating. Don't like to cut you off in your prime, but I am going to. I'm going to win the poll. So over 70%. Thank you very much. Let's share the results. So again, we don't have clarity. We have clarity. We don't have consistency. That was what I was thinking of. So we've got 45% of people saying, yes, my organization does. And that's great. So over the last month, I've seen that number go up. But 21%, nearly a quarter, are saying, no, they don't. What? I mean, we're in August. People are going to start going back September, kind of holiday and all that kind of stuff. A third of people don't know. So over 50% either know or don't know. Is that good enough? I don't think so. People need to start thinking about this. So let's close down that poll. And of course, the impact of COVID has been unique. I said that before, you know, the way people are going to respond to this. But what has absolutely been highlighted is this impact to our mental health. Look at the costs that they're estimating. And Microsoft did a survey at the back end of last year, over 4,000 people. So it's very valid. 75% of those people said, it's been great. I've spent more time with my family and friends. I'm not sure if they're going to be saying that now as it's been another 6 months, but that's what they said at the time. But a third of them said, you know what? I've had to be more productive, twice as productive, because I'm working from home. I have to justify my existence. 70% said, this has been good. I've had more time to invest in my personal well-being. I choose when I go for a walk or cycling or whatever you do. But over half then said, do you know what? I've also been working longer hours. I've taken fewer breaks. I haven't had that natural commute to work, which has given me a break before and after work, kind of to wind up and wind down. And so what really this is saying to me, and this is Abraham Lincoln, it was attributed to Abraham Lincoln, is that you can please some of the people all of the time. You can please all of the people, but only some of the time. And you can't please all of the people all of the time. So when I talk to my clients, I say, stop trying to please all of the people all the time. You will fail. But do what you think is the right thing by getting people involved, not just telling them what to do and listening to them. And of course, there may be some things that we just may not miss. So I hope I don't offend anybody with this. It's just a bit of tongue in cheek, but it's real. It's real.
Oh my God, did he fall?
And it's really challenging, I know, with children home from school and working from home. But just trying to just keep all of those distractions out of the...
The whole page comes down.
No, don't touch the computer. The whole metal part of the screen.
The monitor itself.
Don't use the mouse.
Okay. No, whatever. It says mute, stop video.
No, I don't want you to do anything on the computer.
Share screen.
I don't want you to do anything on the computer.
In reality, I've heard that social work kind of has very high standards and like good standards of other professions don't have.
Hold on.
What's up? Tony, I can see you.
We can all see you.
Now, these are all genuine. Last week when I was doing this presentation to a client, a guy comes on, it was really hot, he was topless. So these things are happening. So for this topic, if any of you got any questions, please put them in the chat and then Amanda can look at them at the end. But what I want to talk about now, and our last one, is habit number four. It's called think win-win, and I want to talk about this psychologically safe environment. So what is it? So the reward of such efforts will be a more resilient, more talented workforce and a more robust and equitable society. Fantastic. McKinsey, another one of those management consultants, I'm obviously kind of keen to get evidence from them. And the psychological safety that they refer to is a belief that no one will be punished or humiliated for speaking up with ideas, questions, concerns, or mistakes. And this has been around about 20 years, but as I said, it's become very popular now. If you can get that right, you can expect to see high levels of engagement, increased motivation, more learning and development opportunities. In other words, you've got people from Harvard and Stanford, the biggest business schools in the world, saying this is a good thing. And there are four stages of feeling safe. So safe to talk about the things that we're talking about. There we go. I knew the dog would bark. I'm just going to pick her up because this is the way. Come here. The best way is to get some. Look at my dog. How can you tell this dog off? Somebody's obviously at the door and I'm now fussing over her. I can put it down. So there, I'm not stressed about it at all. Thank you. Safe to be included. So the need to be accepted precedes the need to be heard. We need to be heard. If we're not heard, if we're ignored, that's really painful. Then it's about safe to learn. When an environment we work in just belittles us or demeans us, it destroys all that ability to learn. And there's about safety to contribute. So when we start to show confidence, we start to contribute to a conversation. We need the autonomy to be able to deliver what it is. We need to see that trust and confidence. And then finally, that's safe to challenge the status quo. And especially when we have high levels of respect and permission, that's great. But when they don't exist, it's going to stifle the things that make organizations successful, like innovation and performance and self-esteem. So this is probably the most sensitive poll that I have. Again, let me assure you that it is anonymous. But I'd like to know, how safe do you feel? Now, let's think about this in terms of talking about how you would like to come back to work, or maybe in general. Okay, I'm going to count down from 25, 4, 3, 2, one. Okay, great. We got over 70. All people are still doing over 70%, which is great because I appreciate it. This is the one that probably is the most sensitive. Let's see what people say. So share the results. Here we go. So 40% are saying, yes, I can say what I want with no fear of repercussion. That's great. But over half of you are saying, you know, I need to be careful about what I say some of the time. And there is still a small proportion of people that still feel uncomfortable. Again, the point of this is if you are in a situation where fortunately you can say what you want, don't just assume that everybody else in your organization feels the same way. We're all different. Right, so let's move on. And let me get your pen and paper ready. We've got this thing called a psychological safety profile. It's a questionnaire. I normally do this virtually, but we don't have time. We don't have the ability to do that. I'm going to show you two opposing indicators, one that's positive and one that's negative. And I want you just to mark yourself, a bit of fun. Nobody else is going to see this. And tell me how you feel. So if you're feeling a bit of low psychological safety, give yourself marks between 1 and 3, high between 8, 9, and 10. And of course, you've got the bit in the middle. And focus on those. Look at what I've written here. And tell me how you're feeling, or tell yourself, because I'm not interested from this perspective. But I'm just going to give you a couple of minutes. I am putting you under pressure because it's just the time that we have. But if you feel that you're more consensus driven than speak up and share ideas, then mark yourself lower and just make a note of that. If you feel that, you know, you focus on professional relationships rather than personal, again, it will be to the left-hand side. And if you're the type of person that really wants to please people, or you're more courageous and you're happy to, you know, take a risk, speak out, even when it's difficult. Again, it's just you making a note of it, if you so wish. But it gets you just to think about what it takes and what it feels like to work in a psychologically safe environment. Now, I am conscious of time, so apologies. That's my fault. I did say to Amanda and Kirsty, I do talk a lot. These are three. I normally do seven of these. Going the extra mile, I'm going to ask you for yourself, wherever you've put yourself, what do you need to stop, start, and continue to do to increase or lower that number? And beware of some extremes. Extremes are not good. And you may want to discuss that with your line manager, something for you to think about. So if you have any questions, please pop them in the chat. But let me just wrap this up. So in terms of key takeaways, look at this. Never in modern history has it been more important for organizations to focus on the experience of their employees. Well, somebody in HR, that's just like manna from heaven for me. It's about time we started to focus on this. But we need to take responsibility for starting that discussion and need to understand who it impacts and how. We need to think about what those outcomes are and why, and not put ourselves under pressure. And we need to think about creating this psychologically safe environment where we're not going to punish people for speaking up. We're going to encourage them to do that. Of course, we need them to do it in a positive way. So let me just end by showing you this video. They're getting ready. How about you?
Morning, folks. This is WGUM, your stay-at-home radio station with better music and more of it. News and weather is on the way. And this just in, we are back. We can see people again. How about that? I can't believe it. News is on the way. We'll learn more in just a moment. I can't believe it.
There were nights when the wind was so cold. But if I just listen to it right outside the window. I finished crying in the instant that you left, and I can't remember where or when or how. And I banished every memory you and I had ever made. But you know this, you hold me like that. Just listen with me, but it's all coming back to me. It's all coming back, it's all coming back to me now. There were moments of gold and there were flashes of light. There were nights of endless pleasure. It was more than any loss in life. Baby, baby, if I kiss you like
some feedback from some clients that too much kissing. So I hope it didn't offend anybody. To me, I think it makes a really good point with a little bit of fun.
Thank you so much, Simon. I think that was a really, really interesting video, and it's so nice to see some warmth and intrigue and excitement for potentially the next phase that they're going to go on. So we've got a final poll, have we, before we've got some time for questions?
I think so. I think it'd be interesting to see how people are feeling now. We asked the question right at the beginning, how they're feeling.
Yeah, let's have a little look, and then we've got about 10 minutes or so for questions. Yeah. So how confident is everybody feeling right now?
Now, of course, it's based on the fact that I made a note of what the numbers were before, which I didn't, but we can look at the recording later. So we have half the people have responded. So again, I'll give you those 30 seconds and count you down from 25, 4, 3, 2, 1. Let's end the poll. Yeah, Okay, and let's share the results. So we've got some people who are still feeling supremely comfortable, which is great. I think the numbers have moved up.
They have, yeah, absolutely.
So that's good. I mean, that's the idea, is to give you some hints and tips about what those things are. So let me stop sharing, because I'm concerned about, we want to have time for, and I'm just, you start talking, because all that's saying is we're going to send out a Super Sevens, that point number three. Amanda's going to send out Super Sevens, which is a summary of what I've been talking about.
Yeah.
So let's get to the chat. I'll shut up.
Okay. All right. So we've had a number of questions and comments coming through as you've been delivering the sessions. So one from Bravna, she asks, do you have any advice on questions you can ask at an interview panel for a new job in this time? How can you be open and robust when being interviewed for a role, particularly questions related to hybrid working, working from home, and health and safety precautions?
Yeah, it's a really good question. What I would say to that is, habit number five is seek first to understand, then to be understood. So the question I would ask them is, what is your policy in terms of whether it's hybrid, working in the office? It's a really good question, because I think we're going to see a shift throughout the working environment, whether it can be organizations like Goldman Sachs that are saying you can only work in the office, and yeah, those organizations like the PwCs of this world who are going to say they don't mind. So you want to find out what they say first rather than tell them what you want. That would be my advice.
Yeah, I think that's really good advice. It's going to become a key component, I think, now when people are thinking about how quickly they're going to run back to that office place. Okay, so Ashley asks, how can managers keep creating engagement and visibility for people in the hybrid environment,
yeah,
and only use the workplace for the right and effective reasons?
Yeah, no, I think that's a brilliant question. In fact, I wrote to one of my clients yesterday, who's an HR director. So I've been delivering to about over 100 people in his organization regarding that. And I said to him yesterday, I said, David, have you thought about how you're going to, shall we say, upskill your line managers who are now going to have to manage people who are partly working from home and partly working in the office? Are they going to be working on the same days at home, on the same days in the office? How are you going to keep that momentum going? Mm-hmm. And I have a catch up with him on Friday, and I'm working with another consultant who's doing that very thing, to start thinking about what sort of help and support can we give people. I haven't got the time to go into the detail, but it's a very good question, because I think that's the next question that needs to be asked.
Okay. And another one from Fiona. She says, starting with why, are PwC genuinely asking what do we want the workplace to look like and not what do we want to accomplish? So what do you think they mean by the first question?
I think, well, I used to work for Accenture, who, as you mentioned at the beginning, were the biggest rivals of PwC. And I think what I've learned, and that was in the 1990s, a very different time. I think there's a real genuineness around that. I don't think it's just a marketing ploy. I've seen over the last 10 years, in particular, that organizations like that, who have always led the way, continue to lead the way, to be absolutely genuine in the way that we should be looking at a whole work environment. So I think there is a genuineness in terms of them asking that, what's the purpose of this? Why do we have to chain people to the desks per se? We don't have to. We can, if our attitude is we can work from home, because we've proved that we can, we've had no choice, then let's be quite genuine about how we see that future and be much more open and flexible about it.
Okay. Yeah, and that segues nicely into this question from Jan. She asks, do you feel that businesses will struggle with running the cost of an office without the full headcount if they do adapt to hybrid working?
Yeah, I think that, sorry.
Do you think this is going to be a factor in businesses wanting employees to return?
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. So in one of the other, I think it's habit number three, which we couldn't talk about, I talk about how we see the office is going to look like. And if you think of a normal bell curve, distribution curve, the majority will be in this middle bit, this hybrid bit. And the question is, okay, how does that impact costs? Because I'm having to pay rent for the whole of that space, and yet it's only being utilized maybe half of the time. Mm-hmm. I think you're right. I think there's going to be this, let's do the right thing and start to get people to be flexible. But I'd be very interested to see what happens, say, in 6-12 months' time, when it will start to change. equally, and this is why I'm saying for people not to rush to make decisions, those people who are saying, yeah, I really want to do this split, might actually find that they actually want to come back to the office because they don't like the distractions at home anymore, or they're feeling alone, and actually they really got something. I think everybody's in that place where they don't know. And so try it. Don't rush to be making a decision. Do something, pilot it, give it a go before you start making a definitive decision.
Yeah, and Darren asks, a big issue is that a lot of people want to return because they miss the social interaction, but with a hybrid approach, obviously the office environment's not going to be the same. So what's the best way to advise people of this, of that sort of point?
Yeah, and I think the simple answer to that is comes back to listening. So seek first to understand, talk to your people and listen to what they're saying. So don't say, for example, we will all work in the office Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. We will all work from home Monday, Tuesday. I think it might suit you, but it's a very direct way of getting what you want. So I think at this stage, it's the opportunity to send out surveys, have conversations about it, meetings, but get information, make an informed decision to see what's going to work best for the majority of people. Remember, it was Abraham Lincoln said, you cannot please all of the people all of the time. There will be people that will be delighted with your decision, but there will be people that will be disappointed. The point is, make a decision, try it for a month, and if it doesn't work, change it, and that's fine. We're very much in this change environment.
Okay, thank you. And just one final comment from Marie, which I completely agree with. She says that we all need to become much more emotionally intelligent in order to create a psychologically safe environment from everyone. Start from a good place with the end in mind, and that will make for a happy and safe place, safe workplace to return to.
Couldn't have put it better myself. Love it. Brilliant. Thank you. Good way to end.
And just a final question from me, Simon. Is there anything that you would urge, other than Kobe's habits, is there anything that you would recommend reading-wise for our group here today? Is there anything that you've read recently or seen as a particularly interesting resource around returning to the workplace that you would recommend?
I am a massive Simon Sinek fan.
Yeah.
In fact, it's amazing. I haven't got any of his videos, but in my workshop, I have five core programs that I run. And Sinek is all over the place. And he actually wrote the book Start With Why.
Yes.
That really got me, because I always thought, you know, you start with what? As a recruiter, you don't ask why, because it puts people on the defensive. So I kind of had to do this paradigm shift. So don't, you know, you can start with why. That was really good. Anything by Sinek, and he's not paying me, I wish he would. Anything by Simon Sinek is really good. Because it's about contextualizing all of these thoughts. So you've got the covers. There's a really good book called The Leader's Window, which I talk about getting the best out of others. And that's, again, it's all about seeking first to understand, then to be understood. I think that's the biggest challenge. So anything that talks about that, you've got Dale Carnegie's How to Win Friends and Influence, but that was written in the 1930s. It's still just as relevant today.
Okay, thank you very much. Well, thank you to everybody for joining us this afternoon for what's been a really interesting conversation, highly relevant. And Simon, you've shared with us so many facts and intriguing points. It's certainly given me a lot to think about. And also, similar to a number of the comments in the chat, I absolutely adore the use of video. Yes, there was a lot of kissing, but you know, it's good. It's good to see some love in the workplace at times. So thank you ever so much. And thank you to everybody for joining us. And we'll look forward to seeing you all soon for another session. Thank you.
Thank you.